it's all about coordination, thinking quick, and having rhythm. When you drive a car on a racetrack, you have to have a certain rhythm that you get into and concentrate. Because if you lose concentration for just a split second, you could end up on the wall or whatever. Or the same on the drums. I have to coordinate between singing and playing. So you've got your hands, your feet, your brain, and for the ballads, you have to put your heart in it as well. So there's another.
I'm no longer counting. I'm not keeping score.
Trying to explain the whole process of cutting is kind of like trying to explain baseball in 5 minutes, you know. It's like,
right.
It's very complex. But what you have to understand is what we're doing here is purely practicing. We're just working the horses out. What you're seeing out there is not show setup. The whole experience of showing at an actual cut and show, the whole setup would be totally different. But your goal is basically to cut the cattle out of the herd. The thing about cutting is, like a lot of rodeo events, it's derivative of, you know, Old West cattle drives. You know, a lot of equestrian events, Western equestrian events, are sort of basically come from things that were done in a working situation on cattle drives, like team roping and calf wrestling and bulldogging and all these things. These are all things that were part of, you know, a cattle drive.
These are Elton's monitors down here. We've got four of these. In fact, there's two large monitors which his piano goes through, and the smaller monitors are what his voice goes through. And he has one large and one small monitor on his left, and one large and one small monitor on his right, and the sound is coming up at his head. And for any technical people out there, the actual volume that is hitting his head, we measured it once and we all freaked out, is 118 decibels, which is louder than a jet engine. So we have a lot of fun trying to keep the separation and the sound clean.
My name is Kevin Bai. Everybody calls me Stick. I am the lighting director and designer for the show. I've been with Elton about 7 years. Yeah, I'm one of the new guys. Basically, I just have to make sure that the lighting is there and it's interesting and kind of jibes with all the different songs. Has to look spectacular. I have to make sure that Elton can be seen and the band can be seen, and also that Elton can see where he's going.
Dennis McManus, the stage manager for Elton John.
My name is Michael Gomez. I'm the production rigger on the tour. And then here at the Red Piano Show, I help Dennis with a lot of the cues that goes on throughout the show.
It involves making sure that everything's set up right, running the crew, making sure the equipment's ready for when we start a show, making sure he's happy when he's on stage, and when he comes off stage, making sure that he was happy then.
I don't think you can learn about how baseball works unless you either play it or you watch it a lot. And when I first came to America, TBS were the only cable channel showing baseball everywhere in America. So I started watching the Braves in the days of you, Monsieur, and Dale Murphy and people like that, when Fulton County Stadium had 3,000 people in it. But I learned because I watched it every day. And it's similar to cricket in that it's very poetic, and it's so many rules. You can't, if you logistically sat down and tried to teach people how to play baseball or how to learn the game, you just can't do it. So I watched it and I fell in love with the game and I learned how it worked, and I loved it immediately, and the Braves became my team.
In honor of Lion King's 10th anniversary on Broadway, the Empire State Building is their outdoor lights up top that they change on a regular basis. For the whole weekend, they're making them Lion King yellow. And the cast and members of the Disney theatrical company are assembling here today. And our Rafiki is going to throw the switch, C.D. Monnier, and make it yellow for the weekend.
Every night, I sign all the drum heads, and what we do, we sometimes we give them away to, if there's young kids in the audience, we give some used sticks or a drum head, or we auction them off for various charities. In fact, the drum head that I used on the Live 8 concert, we auctioned that off for £6,000 in England for a breast cancer charity. So every little bit helps, you know.
A few days ago, Jimmy Page was on a radio show in the UK talking about the upcoming Led Zeppelin reunion that's in a few days' time. And they were talking about the O2 Arena, which is where they're playing. And apparently a lot of big acts have gone in there recently and have had trouble with the sound. And he quoted a few bands, Stones being one of them. I can't remember the others. But he said that he understands, in fact, apparently he was there at Elton's show that we played there a few months ago when we did the Red Piano show there. And apparently Jimmy was in the audience and thought the sound was pretty good. And so he said, I think I'm going to have to speak to Elton's sound engineer to find out how to get a good sound in the O2 Arena. So when I heard that, obviously I was quite chuffed. Finally
on our way. We've got it down pretty well. We've done 145 shows now.
It's a little payback for all the hard work you're on the road.
Normally when we're on tour, it's more just him and the band and a nice backdrop. Here it's like a real show where we have the videos going, every song's different, the scenery popping up at different times.
The stage, you know, is just by far one of the best ones in North America for sure. It's just so beautiful. And all the automation we have with the winch systems and how we bring in the E, the L, the T, O, N, how retro they are, you know, you've seen it, and really old school neon, and the whole show is just really unique in so many aspects.
Elton, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
When it comes to your music and your lyrics, when a song comes to you or someone writes it, you write your own, is it you that determines or your manager determines that's going to be a hit and I'm going to go ahead and record it?
No, I write the songs and record them first, and then it's up to, in the old days, the record company chose which singles were going to come out. I mean, I remember I didn't want Benny and the Jets to come out as a single because I wanted Candle in the Wind to come out first, and Candle in the Wind never came out as a single off Yellow Brick Road. And Benny and the Jets went on to be my first big R&B record, which meant it played on black radio, which for me, being a white boy from England, was, and loving black music, was a huge, huge honor. So I'm usually the worst. Artists are usually so close to things that they sometimes make the worst decision. There's been three records that have been number one records: Sacrifice in England, Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me, Benny and the Jets, which I fought tooth and nail not to come out. And I mean, I've been completely and utterly wrong. It's sometimes, you know, when you play sport, you can't see the wood for the trees sometimes. You know, I want to play this number in the order, and the manager says, no, you should be playing this number. And you think, no. You know, you just have to listen sometimes. But it's weird. That's what's so great about the record business. You never know. It's like in baseball, you know, you can be six runs down in the ninth and you can come back and win it. And it's those are the nice surprises in sport and in music, when something unusual happens and you don't know, and you think, God, I would never have chosen that, and it becomes a big hit.
We are proud to celebrate the 10th anniversary of The Lion King. Since its Broadway opening in 1997, The Lion King has been seen by more than 45 million people worldwide. It has also garnered more than 70 major awards, including 6 Tonys. This show has not been content with a fantastic local run. It has also made a mark all around the world. In fact, 8 different incarnations of The Lion King delight audiences in New York, 2 tours across the US, London, Hamburg, Tokyo, Johannesburg, Paris, and beyond each night. We proclaim Tuesday, November 13th, 2007 in the city of New York as The Lion King on Broadway Day.
I mean, being at the State Building, I've never been to the State Building, and it was like, oh my God, now I get to put my foot in here. And not only that, light that thing for the whole show for the 10th anniversary. I mean, I know I'm not doing it for myself. I'm doing it for everybody that's in the show, you know, that has been in the show even before. And I feel very honored that this day is dedicated to me. You know what I'm saying? I feel very great.
Ever since I was a kid, I always wanted to have horses and have a ranch. But I didn't want to play at it. I didn't want it to be, you know, quote unquote, you know, a dude ranch situation. I wanted it to be the real thing.
Lighting on this show is very, very different because this is not per se a lighting show. This is more video. As we have the video wall, which is a giant light source. So I have to compete with that. David LaChapelle has very, very specific ideas of what he wanted for the show. And as a filmmaker and a photographer, he doesn't think about lights or concert lights as part of the show. It's a tool to use for video and photography. And he's never lit a stage show before. So this show's completely different. I wouldn't call it a lighting show. We just tried to strive for a really, really clean look across the stage.
It's a different thrill. But I get really, really nervous before I go on stage every night. It's like sitting on the grid before you go out to race. The adrenaline kicks. In fact, I don't even have to have a watch. Around about 7 o'clock, it'll kick in that, oh, it's almost time to get ready to go and rock.
When I finished my career, I went into independent baseball, and we had an initiation for the rookies on the team.
Right.
And the initiation was you had to sing a karaoke song, and I sang Yellow Brick Road.
Oh my God!
In front of everybody, and hopefully it wasn't on tape.
That's a hard song to sing.
Elton John, yeah.
He's the best. He's wonderful. Elton John.
Oh, very excited. We're excited.
You only get one chance to see Elton.
This is my first. I'm so excited I can hardly stand it.
Well, that's what the fans love to see. They love to see the human element. They like to see someone who performs and has a rapport with the crowd, and that's the secret. You can sell as many records as you like for a long time, and then it dips because someone else will come over and take your crown. And the longevity is all down to being able to play live and the communication that you have with that audience. And it's why people will always go and see, you know, big stars play sports, because, you know, it's exciting. It's live. It happened. It's happening. Live music, live sports. You don't get a chance to see that. It's never going to happen again. And the performance won't be the same the next time. I think it's gonna be a long, long time.